3, the thrilling conclusion to the Henry Thomas Murphy storyline. Written way back in my youth, when I used to write short stories all the time, I'm reading them aloud to the internet. So if you haven't seen part 1 and 2 of this story, go check it out over here, and then come back and watch the conclusion, because this will be the last part. And also the last bit of the last short story that I will be reading in this location, with that ever-changing painting. So let's jump back into it. The past few days have been slow. I've enjoyed the relaxation. Sigh, I'm not ready to go back to work. Of course I will, I kinda need the money. The weather is much, much colder than when we left. I made the mistake of not bundling up my clothes to work. They had spare work gloves there, but they didn't do much to keep me warm. I'll be adjusting my clothes choices for the future. I arrived home from work today, Journal, and it almost broke my heart to see the veil, as it were, visibly covering Peter's face, and not even more than a day into his work. I have been putting it off, but clearly, I can't leave it anymore. I fear for what my brother is becoming. He is quiet and shifty and irritable, even more so than before Christmas. Kat noticed it too. I just want my brother back. The short time with him at Christmas showed the drastic change that has taken place in him slowly. Now it's a sudden reverse and I can't live with it any longer. January 6th, 1969. Peter's behavior is a roller coaster. It confuses me. Some days he's tight-lipped and doesn't want to talk about anything. He doesn't smile much and goes about the day like a robot. On other occasions, he's optimistic and driven. To what mysterious ends, I'm never sure. In a word, unstable. He confides in me that he is thinking of proposing to Kat. I think that's kind of quick, but he's impatient. He says one never knows how near the end is and doesn't want to waste time. I just hope he holds off a little bit. I'm not at all convinced that Kat would say yes at the moment, and I wonder what a rejection would do to him. I just don't know what to do, Journal. He's clearly still up to something. I have no more proof than before, but it's more clear than ever that he's not the same, and there is something he's not telling me. January 8th, 1969. On Peter's good days, one of his pet projects is the mining work conditions. He and Kat have started talking about them again. Peter's getting pretty agitated with the mining company. He and Kat know they are doing it on purpose because it's going to cost them money, but the conditions aren't safe, especially with the cold turn in the winter. Methane and coal dust are floating in the air without proper ventilation systems. Dangerous levels of it just floating around. At least that's what Kat says. She says that's the worst of it, but it's not the only thing that should be changed. They finally got that committee together to make changes, but they aren't helping much. It's getting pretty frustrating to keep hearing about everything pushing against these changes that apparently need to be changed. Then again, I'm not an expert. January 9th, 1969. Turns out, the committee that Peter and Catherine tried so hard to make is headed by some of the same people in power over at the mining company. What is it with all of these roadblocks in this project? They still aren't done yet, just given enough time. Peter and Kat will figure out how to get those roadblocks and get changes made. They are driven people, and I know they'll succeed eventually. All they need is more time. January 12th, 1969. Journal, it would appear that the inevitable has happened. Peter and Kat have run out of time to fix the problem. As predicted, the unsafe work conditions have led to a disaster, of which the full extent of the damage is not even known, by me or presumably anyone else. This is what I know so far. There was an explosion in the fifth route. I was in the next tunnel over and felt the shock. The rumble caused a cave-in and trapped me and seven others in Tunnel 6. This far into the route, there are no ventilation shafts, and I'd estimate we have about a week of air to breathe, but I could be off by a lot. It was not an explosives day today, so I can only assume the explosion was due to what was predicted, methane and coal dust in the air, ignited by a stray spark. Because we are trapped down here, I have no more information about what happened or if anyone was seriously hurt. Almost immediately after the dust cleared, the eight of us started frantically trying to dig our way out of the rubble, but a couple of men took charge in calming everyone down. They said we have to be smart and not exert ourselves in a way that would waste oxygen, so we worked at digging much slower and took turns. However, the strategy lays more with waiting to be rescued, because we have no way of knowing how deep the rubble is. I hope help comes soon. January 1969. We explored the whole small area we are trapped in. It's a bit bigger of an area than I thought, but the air is already noticeably thinner. We do little to exert ourselves and sleep as much as we can. It somehow seems natural to make little noise as well. We move about, if we move at all, with the most silent steps we can, for no reason other than it feels right. We are all on edge about what to do. Some say we should try to dig out more than we are, but others reason that help is on the way and it's only a matter of conserving air and energy. January 1969. Sleeping is getting tiresome, ironically. It's getting easier to sleep with the loss of oxygen, but no one wants to.
I presume it's been around 3 days now, and restlessness reigns among the group. Still no sign of help, and that makes me feel uneasy. January, 1969. We can now hear the faint digging. There are people coming to rescue us. This is the first sign that we have that we may be saved. Despite this development, the cramped quarters seem smaller every day. Though I have no way of knowing how many days we have passed, it feels like it's been a week since we were first trapped. But there is no real way to tell down here in the dark. Our battery headsets have one by one started to die. It took us way too long before we thought to keep all but one off to save power. My eyes are constantly droopy, though I don't want sleep, and I'm drifting off as I write this. Whether it's night or day outside, it is perpetually night in here, and the almost rhythmic digging softly lulls me to shut my eyes. January, 1969. Journal, I feel our time wears thin. No one wants to dig anymore, because everyone is so tired and short of breath. I've decided to pass around the leftover pages of my journal so all 8 of us can write letters to our loved ones in case help doesn't arrive soon enough. The digging can still be heard faint, but it has not grown at nearly a fast enough pace. It's a strange thing to feel the air is both thick and thin. I feel its thickness like a shadow draped over me, but I feel its thinness as if I were trying to catch my breath on a high mountaintop. Some people say that the strangest things come to mind when death looks them in the eyes. But I find myself pondering over just exactly what I'd expect to be thinking about in a time like this. How would my death affect those I love? What will become of my brother and Kat? What will happen to Rosie and the plans we had for our future? I hope she doesn't waste too much time pining over me. I said as much in my letter, so I hope she heeds my advice. It occurs to me that the situation with my brother and his job was never resolved, not even close, and I still worry about if he'll come around. Will my death throw him over the edge of sanity, or cause him to become reckless in his scientific pursuits, putting any test subjects he uses in greater danger? Will Kat be able to get through to him first? I can only pray things work out if I don't make it out, breathing. And I don't have much faith that I'll make it out. Journal, this may very well be the last entry. We all hold out hope of being rescued, but it's been so long already, and our mind is cluttered with sluggish thought. I read over all I've written within your pages, all those memories. My mind wanders to all the memories I haven't yet told you of. The story of the blue duck that still remains untold, and countless childhood adventures I never recorded. My mind wanders now to all the memories not yet remembered, the ones I know in my heart I'll never get to have. My wedding day, or having kids, grandkids, and on. Continuing the Murphy family legacy, my legacy, Henry Thomas Murphy's legacy. We all hope we will make it out. But I feel as though most know we will not. Fighting off sleep has become a very difficult battle, and the more I fight it, the more I wonder if it's worth it to stay awake. I listen to the digging, too tired to do any digging myself. I've finished writing my letters, and sleep reaches soft arms towards me. My only real hope now is that my letters and the letters of the others are found and given to those they are intended for. Good night, Journal. Even if this is the afternoon, good night. The end.
Ay, ay, ay.
All things considered, I am still pretty happy with how this story turned out. I think on a scale of 1 to 10 pages, I'm going to give this one a solid 7 pages. What do you think? Let me know down below what you rate my story here. So Henry Thomas Murphy, I mentioned in part 1, was meant to be backstory to the horror story that I was writing. So what this backstory is, and what the main characters of the horror story were going to find out as they found and pieced together these parts of the backstory and pieced together the story, is that Henry Thomas Murphy's brother, Peter Murphy, was going to be the horror villain, the antagonist to this book. He was going to be this scientist who went insane because he was not allowed to work on human test subjects and then all these things, and then his brother died while he was trying to get the mine repaired so that wouldn't happen. And this backstory with other newspaper clippings that I was going to write later would spell out the story of how he went insane and now lives in a mansion nearby this cabin, and then he secretly rigged the cabin to open up into this psychological testing arena, as it were, and that would be where the protagonist of the story had ended up. And I had planned on having one or two of the protagonists end up finding a way out that led into the mines. So like Peter, the crazy scientist, had built this testing center around the mines that had collapsed and had been abandoned. And that's how they would find out about the story.
And if you notice there, I had the little moment at the very end where he goes, the Murphy family legacy, my legacy, Henry Thomas Murphy's legacy, because that was going to be like one of the last things they found that connected all of the dots and pieced together who this was writing the journal and how it connects with the newspaper clippings about the cave-in, which would have mentioned Henry Thomas Murphy and linked him together with his brother as you're piecing together who his brother is, and it would all come together at that moment when you figure out who's writing the journal, telling the protagonist of the horror story why the horror villain was doing what he was doing. Which still sounds like a really cool idea to me, and I would love to pull that off, but the rest of the book was not coming together in an exciting way, and so I just kind of dropped that project. But I left this part of the backstory as its own little separate short story. So there you have it. All three parts complete. So until the next time I do this, thank you for reading with me, and I will read with you again at some future undisclosed date.